John D. Intihar. In the mid-80s, my mother brought myself and my two brothers, three future Air Force veterans, to Washington, D.C., where we saw all the great statues and memorials that you expect to see. And eventually, we made our way to the Vietnam War Memorial. As a young boy, I perhaps didn't fully understand or appreciate the full scope or meaning of the memorial. But as we made our way down the memorial walk, my mother brought us to a line in the memorial that read John D. Intihar. John, like myself, was born in Jamestown, New York. My mother and John were high school classmates before he went off to war and she went off to raise a family. When John was killed in Vietnam, it left a lasting and permanent scar on my mother. She came to encapsulate much of her understanding of the Vietnam War and that era in the loss of her classmate, John. And through John and watching my mother, I learned my first lessons in the cost of war, the spirit of sacrifice, the strength of courage, and a dedication to loyalty and service. John D. Intihar, a man who I never met, but a hero who I'll never forget. Today, as we rededicate the Vietnam War Memorial here at Soldiers Memorial, you're going to hear the names of 468 St. Louisans who lost their lives in Southeast Asia during the Vietnam War. As each of these names are read, I urge you to remember that each one of these heroes made the ultimate sacrifice for you and me. Each of these individuals had a rich and full life. They lived with hopes, dreams, and solid plans for the future, all while surrounded by family and friends within the richness and complexities of life. They sacrificed it all so that others, you and I, could live in freedom and pursue happiness.
Good morning. We gather today to honor those members of our armed forces who made the supreme sacrifice while in service to this great nation. Yet, as we do so, we are also reminded of those whose fate is still unknown, those still listed as missing in action and prisoners of war. Over 72,000 Americans are still unaccounted for from World War II, 7,500 from Korea, 1,500 from Vietnam, and 126 from the Cold War, and 6 from the Gulf War and other conflicts. These courageous Americans who dedicate their lives to preserving and protecting our freedom will never be forgotten. Let us remember and never forget their sacrifice.
Thank you. Now, as we begin formal remarks for the program, I'd like to introduce first Dr. Jody Sowell, President and CEO of the Missouri Historical Society.
Good morning, and welcome to Soldiers Memorial. This memorial that you're looking at was dedicated in 1936. Franklin Delano Roosevelt came to St. Louis. This was part of what he said. We in America do not build monuments to war. We do not build monuments to conquest. We build monuments to commemorate the spirit of sacrifice in war, reminders of our desire for peace. Memorial Day is about honoring those who have made the ultimate sacrifice. And today's Memorial Day commemoration is all the more special that we are able to rededicate the Vietnam War Memorial with 254 additional names of St. Louisans who served and made that ultimate sacrifice. I want to thank the staff for their tireless efforts, not just today, but every day, to make this a memorial that is special and that people want to come back to. I want to thank our board and sub-district, especially the Soldiers Memorial Committee, led by Don Avon. I want to thank the City of St. Louis and especially the Soldiers Memorial Commission for being true partners. But I especially want to thank all of you for being here and keeping alive the true spirit of Memorial Day. One final quote from FDR on those dedication ceremonies. He said, "May the beauty of the monument which is rising on this site cast a beneficent light on the memories of our comrades. May its substantial structure typify the strength of their purpose, and may it inspire future generations with the desire to be of service to their fellows and to their country." I hope today, yes, on a somber and reflective day, also creates that kind of inspiration for you. After you've gone through the memorial, I would invite you to come into the museum and see how we tell military history through the lens of St. Louis from the Revolutionary War all the way up to today, and especially to visit our Vietnam War exhibit. I think when you see how people have sacrificed, you will be inspired to serve this community and this country in your own ways. And that could not be a better way to honor the people who made the ultimate sacrifice. Thank you very much.
Now I'd like to introduce Rose Noonan, Commander, American Legion Department of Missouri.
Veterans, families, guests, today we're here to honor all of our brothers and sisters who have paid the ultimate price and the ultimate sacrifice. Today I'm going to put names on just a few of these. Their mission was noble: evacuate desperate civilians yearning to escape a brutal regime. The 13 U.S. service members who died during a terrorist bombing in Afghanistan just under 2 years ago will not be the last American heroes to make such a sacrifice, but they represent the best of a generation. There was Navy Corpsman Max Soviak of Berlin Heights, Ohio. His high school football coach described him as fearless. He was 22 years old. Army Staff Sergeant Ryan Naus of Corrington, Tennessee, member of the 82nd Airborne. He was 23. Marine Staff Sergeant Darren Hoover of Salt Lake City was serving his third tour of duty in Afghanistan. He was 31. Marine Corps Sergeant Johanny Rosario Picardo of Lawrence, Massachusetts, was a member of her brigade's female engagement team, responsible for screening civilians while respecting cultural sensitivities. She was 25. Marine Corps Sergeant Nicole Gee, Sacramento, California, posted an Instagram photograph of herself cradling an Afghan baby, and the caption it said, "I love my job," just days before the attack. She was 23. Marine Corporal Hunter Lopez, Indio, California, was a son of two Riverside Sheriff's Department officers. He was 22. Marine Corps Corporal Dagan Page of Omaha, Nebraska, was a longtime Boy Scout and diehard Chicago Blackhearts fan. He was 23. United States Marine Corps Corporal Humberto Sanchez of Logansport, Indiana, was on the homecoming court during his senior year in high school. He was 22. Lance Corporal David Espinosa, Rio Bravo, Texas, played with toy soldiers as a child and told everyone he knew he would someday be a Marine. He was 20 years old. Lance Corporal Jared Smith of St. Charles, Missouri, liked to play video games. According to his father, he was 20. Lance Corporal Dylan Marola of Cucamonga, California, had been in Afghanistan for just more than a week. He planned to attend college and study engineering. He was 20. Lance Corporal Riley J. Collum of Jackson, Wyoming. He and his wife were expecting a baby when he passed away at 20. Lance Corporal Kareem Nakui of Norco, California. He was 20. Not only are these diverse men and women forever in our hearts, but for those who knew them, they are forever young. They came from every background, yet they shared a common goal: to serve America and make life better for others. It was the same ethos that drove our Korean War veterans 70 years ago. George Andrew Davis Jr. was a World War II flying ace with the Army Air Forces before taking his remarkable skills to the newly created U.S. Air Force. Flying an F-86 Sabre, he downed 14 North Korean, Chinese, and Soviet aircraft. Major Davis was 31. He was promoted posthumously to Lieutenant Colonel and awarded the Medal of Honor. His citation states, his indomitable fighting spirit, heroic aggressiveness, and superb courage in engaging the enemy against formidable odds exemplified valor at its highest. From the American Revolution to the global war on terrorism, more than 1 million American veterans have made the supreme sacrifice. They died so that we could continue to cherish the things they loved: God, country, and family. That is why we gather here on Memorial Day, to honor the memory of our fallen warriors who have given everything for their country. We are also reminded on this day that brave men and women have always stepped forward to take the oath of allegiance as members of America's armed forces, willing to fight and, if necessary, die for the sake of freedom.
Thank you, Rose. Now I'd like to introduce the mayor of this great city of St. Louis, Mayor Tishaura Jones.
Good morning. I'm Mayor Tishaura Jones, and it is a privilege to be here with you in honor of Memorial Day. Thank you to the Missouri History Museum for the invitation to speak and be with you this morning, and to Soldiers Memorial Museum for hosting. And thank you to all who have participated in today's program. My family has a rich history of military service, stretching all the way back to World War I. And my dad is a Vietnam veteran. So veterans and the challenges they issue that they face are close to my heart. Last Memorial Day, St. Louisans came together to honor a veteran who passed away in 2021 with no identifiable next of kin. Our communities joined together to honor his service and inter him in Jefferson Barracks Cemetery. It's that kind of selflessness and camaraderie that makes our city so special. And on this Memorial Day, we mark another solemn and momentous occasion. This year, St. Louis adds more than 200 names to our Vietnam Memorial in the Court of Honor. Due to the hard work of those present today, more than 254 previously unidentified St. Louis and St. Louis County service members who lost their lives in war have been given their names back. This recognition, nearly 50 years since the end of the war, is a powerful reminder of how the work honoring our veterans and service members that we have lost never stops. These new dedications bring to mind a very particular Bible verse, Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 1, which reads, "A good name is better than any precious ointment, and the day of death than the day of birth." It's fitting because today we reflect on the good names of those service members, both literally and figuratively. Their physical engraving on the memorial and the reclamation of their sacrifice, a powerful tribute that enshrines their service to our country as we enjoy the freedoms they fought to protect decades and many generations after. To the loved ones of all war veterans lost in service, and to the families of those to be newly engraved on this memorial, we salute your strength and we join you in lifting their memories today and every day forward. As we honor their sacrifice, we remember that their death, while painful for those in mourning, is another stage of life for those who have passed on. Thank you, God bless you, and have a safe Memorial Day weekend.
For our final remarks, before the reading of the names, I'd like to introduce Bob Fullstone. Bob is a U.S. Army veteran, 1968 to 1974. He's been a relentless champion for fellow Vietnam War veterans and really all veterans. He was rightfully honored as the Missouri Athletic Club's Veteran of the Year in 2014, and has been a longstanding member of the Vietnam Veterans Roundtable. Bob worked closely with the USO of Missouri for the opening of a USO facility in the East Terminal of the Lambert Airport, as well as a mobile unit to support both Scott Air Force Base and Fort Leonard Wood. Bob has also worked tirelessly to organize the St. Louis Veterans Business Resource Center to support aspiring veteran entrepreneurs. He's also worked to support homeless and struggling veterans through the Area Stand Down Project and the new Salvation Army Veterans Residence. Simply put, Bob has been a model of service before self and excellence in all we do. Mr. Robert Fullstone.
My goodness gracious, what an introduction. Thank you. And again, I bring greetings from the board of the Soldiers Memorial and from our staff and our wonderful volunteers that work so hard to make this place really work. So today, I wanted to start by just saying that, first of all, I'd like any Gold Star families to please stand and be recognized. Any Gold Star families here today? Thank you. Thank you. And now I'd like to give a shout out to my non-buddies and say, welcome home and please stand up. And last but not least, everybody who's either served or is now serving, please stand up and be recognized. Well, as Jack Buck, I had the privilege of working with him at KMOX, said to me one time, he said, Bob, if you're making a speech, make sure you shut up before you think you should, and you'll have a good speech. So I'm going to try to do that in Jack's honor, who went to veterans' homes all the time and never made a big to-do, no entourage of media behind him. He just did it. That's the way Jack was. So on Memorial Day, there's a lot of talk about numbers. How many of this? How many of that? Well, they're not numbers. They're people. And that number, that one number, represents another group of people, mothers, fathers, sisters, brothers. So we can't just say it's one person affected. And that's the problem with what we're dealing with today. We need to make sure we take care of our veterans. So I have, in 1979, we had 214 names. Now, because of the hard work of so many other people, we're going to add the names today. And what's really interesting, all of these numbers, it's been 50 years, as mentioned, since we left Vietnam, hard to believe. And that actually, supposedly to the numbers, 7.9 million of us served between 64 and 75. There's a lot of misinformation about Vietnam. One of them is that everybody was drafted. Well, the draftees did get the short end of the stick. But believe it or not, 70% of us who served in Vietnam were considered volunteers. for our country, and often that's never reported. So why did I say welcome home? Well, a Vietnam veteran knows it as a code word. And the reason is we were not well received for our service in Vietnam. My roommate in college, a good CBC boy from Afton, was an FO with a big red one, and he came home and he was warned, as I was, well, you, that there'll be protesters outside, and there were lots of protesters. Well, Kim obeyed the rules and he didn't wear his uniform, got into civvies, sat down on the plane, and the guy next to him said, hey kid, you've got a great tan. You been on the beach? Kim said, well, no sir, I just finished my tour in Vietnam. Guy reached up, called the stewardess button and said, stewardess, I would like to have another seat. That was his welcome home. And we've had the privilege at the History Museum of having a really great author, James Wright, who wrote a book, Enduring Vietnam, An American Generation at War. And he interviewed probably 40 different veterans, Vietnam veterans, and how was their welcome home? Well, he talked to this one ranger who had just finished up his tour, and he was wearing his Class A uniform, very proud of his service to his country. And he's at the airport, and he sits down, we're getting ready for that plane to take off. Well, he's the only guy there. All of a sudden, getting closer to the time the plane takes off. So all of a sudden, lots of people show up, you know how it goes. Well, there were only two empty seats in that whole place. And you know what they were? The seats next to him. He just sat there and bawled, because that was his welcome home. Then at LAX, this couple went, their son was in Mekong. They had a beautiful sign, welcome home, and they're at the airport. And all of a sudden, people started yelling at them, baby killer, baby killer. This was his family's welcome home. So we have to always remember with the Vietnam veteran that this was not what we wanted. We became the scapegoat for the people that were planning all this. We became the scapegoat. So I wanted to talk about these stories. There's one good story in the book, and it's about a guy who's walking along, he's got his duffel bag on, so obviously he's a military guy, and a truck hears his horn beeping behind him, bam, bam, and he thought, oh crap, here we go again, I'm gonna get, you know, hit on. And the guy rolled down his window. I'm old school, he rolled down windows in those days. And he said, thank you for your service. Can I give you a ride? And he said it touched him so much that anyone in those times was very friendly and kind and gave him a true welcome home. So if I ask, you're all involved, so that's really cool. But if I were to say, what percentage of the population today is serving in the military? Less than 1%, 0.8%, 0.8%. So, you know, is we have to still be on guard, we have to still be on front, and we need to protect those that are serving us today. And that's the other point I want to make. Is that I just saw a report here from the State of Missouri Veterans Commission. It is discussing a 9% or 14% increase in the monthly living of veterans in homes. Most of these veterans are on fixed income. So where is that money going to come from? I realize it's a horrible situation to deal with, but we need to make sure that we are still involved in trying to protect those who have served us. So, as mentioned, I've been involved with a couple of organizations, the USO, and Joan Went and her family have been very generous, the Kauffman Fund, Gateway Warriors, which is a takeoff of the national, but every dollar is a dollar in helping a veteran, Focus Marines, a tremendous program here in St. Louis, and it's helped innumerable a lot of people with real issues from being at war. And if you haven't seen the Salvation Army Residence Center, it's right up here on Locust. And it's, a veteran can stay there for up to 2 years, and each has an apartment, and each has a kitchen. Starting point one, you have to cook your own meals. Nobody's gonna cook anything for you. And it's very well done. They're able to make sure it's very secure, because we know that the bad guys want to come in and reignite use of drugs or whatever else it may be. So it's a beautiful place, and just when you're driving up, you can take a look at it. It's really very good. So I want to, encourage you, as Jody did, to go in and see the exhibit on Vietnam. I think it's been well done. Mike and his team did a good job. But also, there, I always say this wrong, it's a loge, the big black thing up there, and it's got 1,072 names of people from St. Louis that gave their life in World War I and was dedicated here. And again, it's not about the numbers. We got to multiply that with family, friends. So it is, and I want to remind you, another date's coming up, because I'm sure you all saw the coverage of on March 29th about National Vietnam Veterans Day. Did you see all that coverage? I didn't. But coming up in September, on September the 15th, is MIA POW Day. And so I encourage you to talk it up with, if you talk to radio stations, hey, are you gonna do anything for that? Because we have to be the advocates, because there's less and less people available to promote and help and support our veterans. Oh, and because I'm the speaker, I get a personal note. And the personal note is, where's my wife, Kathy? Anyhow, she's out here somewhere. Stand up. Anyhow, she is, there's my hero right there. She supported me through basic training, through AIT, through TDY deployment from Fort Sill to Fort Gordon to everywhere, Vietnam, and then when I was in the active reserve. And she gets a little help for helping me make sure that this was hopefully a good speech. But, so you can blame her. No. So we've got many issues in front of us in this country. And one of them, and the one that's most important to me, is making sure our veterans and their families are taken care of. The veterans have kind of slid off the shelf here with the media and with people in general. So thank you for coming out today, sitting in the hot sun, and listening to somebody like me talk about veterans. And I'll just say, if you do see a Vietnam veteran, be sure to say, welcome home.
Thank you, Bob, both for the speech and all that you've done for veterans in the St. Louis community and everywhere. Well, I want to give a quick hello and a greeting to the St. Louis police, Chief of Police, who's joined us today. So, thank you. Engraved on the Vietnam War Memorial in the Court of Honor are the names of 468 St. Louisans who lost their lives in Southeast Asia during the Vietnam War. Somebody once said that there are three deaths. The first is when the body ceases to function. The second is when the body is consigned to the grave. And the third is that moment, sometime in the future, when your name is spoken for the last time. May these 468 individuals never experience that last situation. We're now going to read the names of all of the individuals engraved on the Vietnam Memorial, and we will begin with Patricia Blossom.
Gerald R. Abenhaus, Jr., Robert E. Abbott Jr., Robert L. Anthony, Harlan F. Adams, Richard L. Adams, Charles R. Allen, Michael M. Alley, James D. Ames, Herbert F. Emmerheim, William J. Amstutz, Jr., George R. Anderson, Glenn U. Andriotta, Bill A. Ashford, Jr., Raymond A. Osterman, Jr., Tyrone W. Austin, Michael R. Baker, William C. Baker, Stephen W. Bancroft, John H. Barnes, Billy J. Barnett, Jr., Larry M. Bartell, Raymond Bateman, Purcell Bates, James P. Bauer, Rory M. Baum, Bobby R. Baxter, Louis M. Beckman, Carl W. Beers, Jr., Gary E. Beasley, Fred Biley, John D. Belts, James H. Bennett, Jr., Martin Biondo, Rondell D. Bishop, Kenneth G. Blanton, Michael J. Blassie.
Leon N. Bobo, David R. Belliver, Michael D. Bonds, Lawrence G. Bourne, Robert J. Barner Jr., James R. Boyer, Ronald H. Bazinskis, Raymond P. E. Breeding, James A. Bremen, Clarence Brown, Daniel L. Brown, Detro Brown, Harry L. Brown, Harvey L. Brown III, Lawrence J. Bazinski, Larry D. Buffington, John R. Barnes Jr., Leonard Burrow, Samuel V. Barano. Albert Butler, Stephen M. Cady, Howard E. Caffrey, Jerry M. Kane, Floyd D. Caldwell, Thomas F. Callahan, Albert Calamus, Bruce C. Candrum, Robert T. Kornowski, Victor J. Cartier, James R. Cash, Udell Chambers, Gerald A. Champion, Joe W. Chandler, John M. Chappelle, Roger W. Chastain, Alan S. Cherry, Gary A. Sheshire, Ronald W. Child, George W. Childress, Fred A. Chitwood, Jr., Richard D. Corlins, Scott A. Christofferson, J.O. Clarkson, Richard L. Cleveri, Edward Clemens, Charles Clubs, Ernest W. Cole, Robert E. Cook, Richard L. Cooper, Charles A. Cope, Robert Copeland, Ronald J. Corbin, Jackie B. Couch, Donald M. Kramer, James Cochran, Louis J. Cosby, Marvin E. Curry, Paul L. Davis, Leonard J. Dahlman, Michael J. Dalton, Stephen G. Davies, Carl R. Davis, Raymond J. Davis, Donald C. Dean, Charles E. DeLassis, John A. Dennis, Don F. Dion, Ronald G. Dixon, William J. Dillon, Michael J. Dingus, Lawrence A. Durenberger, Ronald J. Doggett, James A. Donaldson, James W. Donnelly Jr., Stephen C. Drake, William A. Duncan, John B. P. Eads, Larry W. Elliott.
These are my, all right. Irvin J. Emmerich, Clinton H. Epps, Ralph H. Ernest, Donald D. Easel, Thomas K. Farrenhurst, Lawrence L. Fant, William D. Farney, Barry E. Feldman, Daniel F. Dunnewald, Jerry W. Farron, Stephen P. Fink, Earl F. Fitch, Thomas E. Foster, Donald L. Fowler, James E. Francis, Albert W. Frazier, Michael G. Frey, Alan G. Fussner, MacArthur Gaffney, Thomas L. Gaines Jr., Curtis Gaither, Anthony J. Galena, Dennis W. Galloway, Jose O. Garcia, Donald J. Garvey Jr., August H. Gensler, Clifford W. Gibbs, David E. Gill, Robert J. Gladue, David C. Glover, Robert J. Good, John W. Golin, Jackie L. Gophers, Barry L. Golden, Douglas D. Gonzalez, Douglas E. Gossage, Thomas W. Kaczynski, Thomas J. Gragnani, Stephen Graham Jr., Harold L. Gray, Demetrius J. Grays, Alan R. Green, Lloyd R. Green. He loved St. Louis. I was with him when he died. I'm glad he's on the wall now.
O. Griffin, Michael Grimes, Charles W. Grizzle, John W. Grutsch Jr., Eugene R. Gudovitz, Walter T. Guerin, Donald H. Guitar, Albert L. Gunn, Christopher Gutierrez, James J. Hagen, Jerry L. Happel, Anthony R. Hardy, Jimmy C. Harper, Marvin Harper, Lee R. Harris, Billy J. Harrison, Green L. Hart, Andrew L. Hastings, Ronnie L. Hawk, Gary L. Hayes, Melvin Hazley, Howard C. Hurd, Richard M. Heck, Norval M. Henn Jr., Billy D. Herring, Larry D. Hicks, Gary Hill, Donald R. Hofeditz, David P. Hoffman, Michael D. Holmes, Oscar L. House, Mark T. Howard, Philip L. Hudson, James A. Hall Jr., Gary D. Holtz, Chalmers C. Humphreys, Richard L. Hupp Jr., Ronald J. Imperial, Warren G. Ingram, Philip T. Ives, Hugh M. Jackson, Lamond J. Jackson, Lewis J. Jackson.
Robert Jackson Jr., Charles Jasmine, Richard L. Jenner, James Giles Jr., Kenneth J. Joannis, Gregory B. Johnson, Lewis Johnson, Xavier Johnson, Karan M. Jones, Gary H. Jones, Larry A. Jones, Michael G. Jones, Wayne I. Jones, Everett R. Jorens Jr., William A. June, Gerald R. Keeney, Lewis F. Keevan, Richard H. Keith, Owen C. Kelly, Thomas D. Kester, Lawrence J. Kindred, David M. King, Ronald J. Kincaid, Willie J. Kirksey, Robert J. Clagus, James M. Klein, Sidney K. Kroger, Jerry B. Kraft, Harold A. Cram Jr., Royal T. Krell, Kenneth J. Kreutz, Larry P. Land, Richard L. Land, Michael G. Langston, Timothy K. LeClaire, Vincent B. Lee, Frank F. Lewis, Leonard L. Lewis, Timothy F. Lacey, Leslie E. Livingston III, William L. Lockhart, Donald G. Logan, Clarence Logwood, Dennis M. Longo, Melvin Lloyd, Thomas L. Lubbers, Ralph J. Lubbers, Jr.
Bernard M. Lubkirk, Frank J. Lukish, Jr., James E. Magel, Wilson L. Mays, Jr., Lewis N. Malin, Edward H. Mann, Anthony Maracy, Jerry M. Marco, Charles W. Merrick, Peter K. Matthai, Dennis R. Maxwell, Michael J. Mayberry, Harry L. Mays, James W. McCoy, Peter J. McCoy, Pleasant McCray, Jr., Michael E. McDaniel, Michael J. McGuire, Charles A. McGurk, Leroy McKeever, John H. McSwine, Carl F. Meyer, Gregory L. Meyer, Harold D. Meyercord, John A. Miller, Jr., Larry F. Miller, William J. Miller, Terry W. Mills, Daniel L. Mitchell, Glenn L. Moeller, Jr., Revis A. Montre, Jr., Lewis C. Moore. Thank you for your sacrifice.
Terry L. Moore, Doyle A. Morris, John H. Morris, Jr., Stephen P. Morse, Wallace J. Mosley, John W. Murphy III, Bernard P. Murray, George A. Myers, Patrick I. Nelms, Larry T. Nelson, William A. New, Donald L. Nixon, John M. Noonan, Brian R. Norfleet, Robert J. Noto, Thomas M. Nowak, John M. O'Brien, Timothy M. O'Neill, Michael J. O'Toole, Michael O. O'Gile, Henry M. Oliver, Vernon L. Ostertag, Joseph W. Parent, Jerry Patrick, Philip A. Paul, Armand J. Percy, Jack A. Perry, Ernest D. Petty, Burton K. Phillips, Jr., James R. Phillips, Danny R. Pierce, Eddie L. Pleasant, Christopher Podmanitsky, Gerald R. Pollard, Jr., Charles A. Poppleton, Gary S. Poskover, my brother, oh shalom.
My friend, Gary Stephen Hoss, Leonard L. Potts, Michael A. Rawl, James D. Preston, James P. Preston Jr., Charles F. Gravel, Ronald P. Prince, William T. Prose, Larry R. Pryor, Richard M. Purcell, Jerome Rawlings, Gregory R. Rayfield, Larry A.H. Raisky, Earl D. Reed, Lonnie M. Reeves, Elmer J. Riffschneider, Jr., Donald J. Riley, Dean W. Reeder, Philip H. Reeder, Jr., Edward A. Rohde, James B. Rice, Jr., Fred E. Richards, Raymond L. Richardson, Richard E. Richardson, Ronald E. Ride, Melvin J. Riley, Jr., Alan J. Robinson, Odell Robinson, Robert L. Rogers, and Philip W. Repke.
In remembrance of Robert P. Rosenbach, Alan Ross, Robert D. Rother, Jr., Gilbert O. Ruff, Jr., Heinrich Ruhlmann, Jesse M. Sanford, L. Sanford, I'm sorry, Michael R. Sample, Ernest Sanzaro, Jr., Jerry J. Sanders, Richard T. Sirakis, Dale E. Sathoff, M. J. Savoy, Terrence R. Sheen, Lawrence F. Scherer, Alvin W. Schlottman, Joseph Schmidt, Jr., John G. Schmidt, Craig A. Schmitz, Peter A. Schrader, Richard J. Schroeder, Eugene C. Scott, Curtis D. Scowden, Thomas W. Shea, William L. Shagag, Ronald E. Shepherd, Bobby J. Shockley, Billy D. Short, Harold R. Silvey, Harold J. Simmons, and Thomas M. Scally.
Courtney A. Skinner, Wayne A. Sandgard, David A. Slosky, Eddie L. Smith, Gary E. Smith, George C. Smith, James E. Smith, Scott G. Smith, Theodore Smith, Walker Smith, Jr., William D. Smith, Norman E. Snodgrass, John M. Snyder, Jr., Michael B. Snyder, John G. Spindler, Joseph F. Smitschucci, Warren Starks, Bing F. Stevens, Edward H. Stevens, Charles H. Stone, Herbert R. Stoneking, Randolph B. Suber, Robert R. Summers, Charles E. Sutherland, William R. Sutherland, Charles M. Swain, Lawrence Swangerum, Lee B. Tate, Danny G. Taylor, and James O. Taylor.
John B. Taylor Jr., Toby A. Thomas, Nathaniel Thomason, Samuel L. Thomason, Frederick H. Timms, James E. Tinsley, Dale L. Tulos, George S. Tulsey III, William O. Travers Jr., Anthony Travasso, Joseph L. Chambers, Press Taylor Jr., Harry W. Underwood, Michael Utley, Harold D. Van Bursky, Harry M. Van Diver Jr., Monty E. Van Syke, Gregory R. Boger, Charles Walker, Lavelli Walker, Randall E. Walker, Ross J. Walker, Jamie L. Wallace Jr., Robert D. Walters, William H. Walters, Ivory Wall Jr., Leroy Ward, Ronald J. Warden, Lynn A. Watkins, Curtis L. Watkins Jr. God bless.
Kenneth L. Watson, Sammy L. Watson Jr., Leonard Webb Jr., Walker N. Weeks, Lawrence M. Weeke, David Widener, Reuben W. Westfall Jr., Freddie L. Whitney, Elvin J. Widener, Robert J. Weese, George A. Williams, John D. Williams, Joseph J. Williams, Lamont T. Williams, Paul M. Willis, Charles W. Johnson, James C. Wilson, Robert Wilson Sr., and James Winfrey. We salute you.
Mm-hmm.